Welcome to the microbial edition of Soilworks Solutions. We're fortunate to have Dr. Tom Dykstra with us.
I think that's the wrong one. I'm at the wrong microbial one.
What you want to do is down the hall to the left.
Oh.
Outside, find the tree, and there'll be a train coming at 4.
Oh, I'm never going to make that. Can I just sit in on this
You're already here.
I'm just going to sit in. Okay. Don't mind me.
There's a lot of talk about microbes. Mm-hmm. Microbes are kind of part of your entomology, bug, insect, critter.
Loosely related.
You look at a lot of stuff like that.
Yeah.
We're getting a lot of calls for people that want to put beneficial microbial packs on treated seed. Or they're asking, can we put these microbes in with our chemical? Or can we do this or can we do that? What we've learned, because we were in the microbial world, we created an extractor many years ago, we perfected it, and we provided a microbial pack, an extract that was second to none, had high carbon levels, had wonderful diversity, had fantastic bacteria and fungal growth in it. But what we were finding out is if you put these great bugs in a horrible environment, doesn't work.
But why?
Gee, if we only had a doctor here
who
could possibly explain that.
Someone's going to need to explain this to the common
right,
man.
Where are we going to go with this? Before you start, we do a lot of business in the state of California, and we sent 3 extractors out there and product. And we said, test them, use them, trial them. Put these microbes down, and these were on different tree crops, different vegetative green mix garden growing crops, and across 300 miles of California. And there was no pressure, there was no sales pitch, there was, tell us what you think. And they all very kindly and respectfully says, you can come get these because we saw no benefit. A big, deep, we just got a cup of what's going on here. So this is quite a few years ago. We started looking to see what this pressure of the soil was. Was it tight? We started looking to see what the sugar content of the plants were. We started looking at all the environment, so to speak.
Yeah.
The community that these bugs had to live in. And what we found is the addition of more microbes in an unfit, unready, unhealthy environment does not financially return what you would hope to. If I've given you enough of a lead-in.
So you want me to take that information and go with it or something to that
effect?
I'd
like you to do something.
Okay. These micro packets right now, we've all talked about, I mean, certainly Glenn and I have talked about it before, about the importance of microbes. And so when you hear about the importance of microbes, you think, aha, you know, I either need to feed them or I need to put them on my soil because microbes are going to save me. Well, of course, they can, and they have the capability of doing so. But there are some problems, which Glenn has just alluded to. So imagine, if you will, to paint an image of your mind, of a man who lives at the bottom of a mountain. And he lives in a small house with his family. Well, this mountain suddenly becomes reactive, and it sends up lava into the air. So it's now an active volcano. As the lava slowly starts to move down the side of the mountain, there's a lot of screaming and yelling. People are running here, there, and everywhere. Dogs and cats living together. You know what I'm talking about here. But now we've got this situation that needs to be taken care of because he thinks to himself, I've got a house. I've got a family. I need to do something to protect them. What am I going to do? He sees the lava coming down. And then it comes to him. An idea comes to him. He goes, I know how to stop this. So he runs into his house, opens up his freezer, and grabs an ice cube tray. And he runs out armed with his ice cube tray at the lava, which is now coming down and threatening his home. And he takes out an ice cube, little cool, and throws it at the lava. What happens? Immediately melts. It's gone. He's thinking, gonna need another one. Takes another ice cube. It's gone. Thinking, I'm gonna need more than two. Grabs another one, throws it at it again. Same thing. Goes through all, let's say, 12 in the entire ice cube tray, throwing it and having the ice cube disappear within a matter of seconds. How effective is that technique against lava, which is going to come down and obviously destroy his house? Obviously, it's a good point to start running at this point. I get that, but I'm just telling a story right now. So what is happening when you take microbes and place them into toxic soil? The same thing that just happened with the ice cubes. You introduce it into the toxic soil and then they're gone. Within a matter of seconds, minutes at most. I don't think they're going to last a few hours or two, but you know, if you got pretty good soil, they might stick. And so you can inoculate your soil over and over again. But if the soil is toxic, you have done nothing except line the pockets of people who are selling these various micro packs. Now, there is, of course, the obvious exception, and that is if you have good, healthy soil and you put down a micro pack, the idea is that this will then inoculate the soil and it will spread relatively quickly. This is true. However, think about what I just said. If you have healthy soil, what do you need the inoculant pack for? Because you've probably got enough microbes in your soil already.
Indigenous.
And native. Yeah, this is the thing about the micro packs is they're often, they're usually encapsulated in a particular state. They're usually using microbes particular to that location, wherever it may be. And so when they put them on your property, what's the chance that they're going to stick, which means live and proliferate? Well, the odds are actually quite small. And so because they're so small, you have to question whether or not this is going to be cost effective. Because you can keep inoculating your soil and over again, but if it's toxic, you're doing absolutely nothing. You are lining the pockets of those you're buying it from, but it's a complete waste of your time. And so therefore, microbes are important. I don't want to downgrade that at all. We've talked about that in the importance of microbes. But there are better ways to get microbial populations up. In part, it's to use indigenous ones, which Glen so aptly mentioned right now. They're there. They're happy, generally speaking. They might need a little bit of help. They might need a little bit of food. Throw some sugar at them. Throw some fish emulsion at them. Throw something that they're going to feed upon in order to increase their numbers, in order to have a beneficial effect upon your soil. That is a far more cost-effective solution than buying micropats, which essentially are small ice cubes that you are throwing at incoming lava. You can see it is not going to help you, so I'm going to urge you in the strongest possible terms to actually think about what I am saying and ascertain whether or not you actually need them. So with that, I'm going to stop talking and see whether or not Mr. Rabenberg has anything constructive to say.
I love the lava story. It creates a mental picture.
Mental picture, yes.
We stopped manufacturing our extractors. We were finding when we started talking with these growers and checking their soil.
Yeah.
We would have been the manufacturer of the ice cube. And that is not what we wanted. We didn't want the phone calls from growers saying, yeah, I bought your extractor. I tried your extract and I haven't seen squat. I want my money back. You can't blame them.
I actually can't.
Farming is expensive.
Yeah.
It's even more expensive if you buy something without doing research. If you don't have microbes in your soil, there's probably a reason that you don't. One, there's probably too much pressure in the soil. Number two, there probably isn't enough BRIX in the plant
yeah.
to have a root exudate to feed it. That's where our calcium has come in. A little bit of our calcium will relax the soil, reduce the surface tension, allow air. The sugar that's supplied with it and the molasses that's supplied with it will start to feed the microbes, and you'll start the process, which end result is higher BRIX.
Right.
And then you will start an ecosystem that when the carbon gets higher in the soil to feed the plant feeds the soil, and now you've got
a sustainable system, which is where the term sustainable agriculture came from, is to find that point where you can actually get things going in a nice clean circle and going relatively quickly, because you don't want it too slow, but you're looking for a quick recovery between that, so that the carbon circulates in the environment the way that it should.
With this, what we've seen in some of the Midwest, and keep your swords down, fellas, but in a no-till situation, if you're curious about the residue that's on top of your soil, measure the carbon to nitrogen, and please do this on a tillage or a minimum till. All growers should know this. We're not playing preference to anybody, but you need to know where you're at. Please check your carbon to nitrogen ratio. A lot of the experts are going to say, well, soil organic matter is where it's at. That's what it's all about.
Isn't that the same thing as carbon?
That's what some people say.
No.
There is carbon in soil organic matter.
Really?
Sarcasm at a very low level.
Oh, it's appreciated. You love it.
Yes. The soil organic matter is a great number, but don't confuse residue on top of the soil for soil organic matter, because many times if you have a young fella driving the pickup with a hydraulic soil sampler, it punches right through a half inch and a half, 2 inches of residue, and is that residue that shows up as soil organic matter? We've talked to several different labs. If you truly want to look at soil organic matter, scrape off the residue, the fodder, what's left, the stubble, because you're doing a soil test, not a residue test. Look at your numbers, look at the carbon to nitrogen, and then also take some of that residue and send it in. Send it in right after harvest, and then send it in a year later. Please let us know how much carbon got to the soil to change your carbon to nitrogen ratio, and how much carbon possibly up and away. Possibly not the news you wanted to hear, but we want to be honest, we want to help solve problems, and we want you to be profitable, and we want you to pass good, healthy soil to the next generation.
Especially want you to be profitable, because too many farmers are going out of business. We've seen the figures right now. We're doing what we can in order to stop that.
The things we talk about are inexpensive, they're common products, and if there's something that we have said that didn't make sense or is possibly confusing, and that could very well be possible, not necessarily from you because you're a doctor.
More so from me, yeah.
Possibly from me, but if something isn't clear, if you'd like more information, don't be afraid to contact us here at SoilWorks, email, phone call, or if you want more information on Dr. Thomas Dykstra, what do they do?
No. What you're going to do, if you have any questions, all of them will be directed to SoilWorks. So I'm just going to ignore all of your phone calls. I will not pick up the phone.
He does not do that. He has a conscience.
All right. If you need to get in contact with me, you can find me at dykstralabs.com. The phone number is there on the website. You can also, if you want to check out a couple videos, maybe you're suffering from insomnia, I'd be happy to help with that. We've got some good, long, scientific videos, which should help put you to sleep. These videos can be viewed on YouTube. Search for Thomas Dykstra. You will find them.
We hope this information has been helpful. If there's information that we haven't given that you'd like to see, and if we're capable of giving you good wisdom and good guidance, please let us know. We appreciate you watching, and we look forward to seeing you on our next video. Thank you.